Thank you very much for this invitation. It's very nice because I met Deniek in 1980 when I was just when we were just starting OMA in Rotterdam, and there was an old bridge across the river that was going to be demolished because they built a new bridge. And this old bridge we thought was very beautiful. So there were several architects who made a design what to do with the old bridge. And we in OMA, we had an idea to put the bridge upright and to make a viewing tower out of it. And Zdeněk had an idea of putting the bridge on a floating raft and make a maritime museum on it. So we were competing when we met each other, and the two projects didn't make it, and the bridge was demolished and kind of taken away. Before I start, I want to give you three books that we just released. This is a little bit of advertisement. The first book is called Noise Landscape, and it's about how the noise contour of airports is influencing urbanization. I will show you a little bit later on how this works and how that can be put into a positive approach to design. The second book is called Urban Loopholes, and it is about the French concession in Shanghai. This is the most beautiful neighborhood in Asia, and it's more or less completely built out of brick in the 1930s, and it is about the parallel emergence of heritage consciousness in the politics in China and creative industries that together are housed in these neighborhoods. And the third one is called State Beyond the State, which is an urbanistic history about the city of Shenzhen. It's one of the biggest cities in the world, in China also. I would like to talk to you about what our approach on the moment is in urban design, and this is an approach of inversion and of subtraction. And I will explain to you how this works. I start with subtraction. It's not a new idea. You must also understand that most architects and urban designers don't invent new ideas. They just reprocess other ideas from the past. So this is the envelope of the New York zoning law depicted by Hugh Ferris in the early 1900s. And it shows how the maximum volume according to the zoning law, which has a setback arrangement and allows 30% of the footprint of a block to be extruded eternally into the sky, how this is being first created as a big volume and then taken down into ever more subtracted volumes until you have real buildings that function according to these zonings. We made a book about that. It's written by my ex-PhD, Alexander Lehner, who now is also a professor at ETH, Grand Urban Rules. It's quite a good book because it's a manual how you can work with urban design guidelines and how you can develop rules that create urban design quality without specifically determining the architecture. And the first project that we as KCAP developed according to that approach was the island of the Wijnhaven in the city center of Rotterdam, which is this big island, and this big tower is our own architecture and is one of the exponents of that urban design principle. This is also a principle of subtraction, because this was the original condition of the island. This building here on the third floor is the very first, here is the very first OMA office in 1980 when Zdeněk came to us. And here the top floor was the second OMA office. This building is now being demolished. These office buildings from the 1950s were very bad. They were half empty. Nobody rented them. And they were too expensive. Their book value was too high to turn them into housing. At the same time, the city of Rotterdam wanted to have more housing in the center. So we devised an idea to allow every owner of a plot, every owner in this island, to create a high rise as high as possible as he wanted, in order to create sufficient volume that could finance the transformation of the island. And remarkably, this was a quite radical proposition. This principle was accepted. And it consisted out of a couple of rules. So towers had to be a little bit sculptural. The towers had to be real towers, not slabs, so that they did not hinder the view. People with small plots could build penthouses, and people with large plots could build towers. And the rules were so that the towers could be done by anybody, on any place, by any architect. Architecture was not controlled. You could make a postmodernist tower, you could make a modernist tower. The idea was that that would be helping the diversity. And so the rule was that nobody was allowed to hinder themselves. And so this is a typical exponent of this rule, where you see the tower here, you see the podium here, you see a plinth of pedestrian urban design facilities. So the rule led to the fact that you could make a big fat tower, but nobody would do that. You could make a very high slender tower, nobody would do that because the tower would only exist from staircases and elevators. So there was a kind of optimum in between that automatically set in. And this optimum actually was also constructed. So the towers that you see here are all working according to this principle. And so because they are not allowed to hinder themselves and have a sufficient sunlight, daylight and view, they were kind of playing a dance, how to position themselves in the right way. So the maximum volume was subtracted by these rules and then created the urban design principle for this neighborhood. A couple of years later, many years later, we are still doing this. We are now working on the railway station area in the city of Zurich. You see the river of Limmat, you see the lake Zurich, this is the inner city, and you see just here in the corner you see ETH, and we are working on the railway station area where we created this urban design model, which was a competition that we won, which simply consists of a new diagonal boulevard, the so-called Europa Allee. Switzerland is not in the EU, but it's called Europa Allee. It's nostalgic. And the streets from the quarters have been continued and therefore form this kind of tissue closing in building blocks. Then the building blocks are allowed to be constructed maximum volume. This is the whole area under construction on the other side. It will be ready in about a year and a half, and they are already starting on the area here. And this is the morphology of blocks that are developing within this framework of streets and diagonals. This is the principle. So you first fill up everything. Don't care about anything. Fill up the site as much as possible, like a big cheese. Then you start cutting the streets out. You start cutting the squares out. You start then cutting inclined planes that follow certain shadow rules or certain daylight and sunlight access aspects, and last but not least, view lines or other parameters. And the result is then that you create an envelope, which is depicted here by the wires, by the wireframe, and the buildings by the different architects and developers can be within this wireframe. If they keep to the wireframe, the urban design works. If they go out of it, then there's a problem. So this is the principle that we apply to that situation. And here you see the buildings under construction. This is, for instance, one of the first buildings by Caruso St. John, which consists typically of an active street front with a gastronomy position. Then there's an office block, and then there are apartments on top of it. Here you see the square under construction with one of those towers. They're all podiums with high rises because we do not like towers to stand on the ground. Like in Weinhaven, we like to develop them a plinth so that there's a transitional zone and you can also create high rise sky gardens and roof terraces. Here you see the Europa Allee, leading Switzerland hopefully once in the EU. And we have every building designed in competition. This is, for instance, designed by Wiel Arets architects from the Netherlands, who won the competition for that building. What is also interesting is that this becomes a kind of ecosystem because these buildings were developed to be rental offices, apartments, old age homes, hotel. There are cinemas, conference spaces, and shops there. These buildings are now for 70% rented by Google because Google wants their European headquarters there. And there's a whole ecosystem of app designers and of coffee shops, co-working spaces that is generating an enormous dynamics in the area, which was not predicted on the moment that we designed it. This used to be planned as Le Corbusier Square. He is a Swiss architect, as you know, but finally politics denied it because Le Corbusier has been anti-Semitic in the 30s and was sympathizing with the fascists, and therefore the square will not bear his name. This is our most recent design. It's a building block in Korea, and it's an enormous building, and therefore we created a kind of monkey rock, like a labyrinth out of it. Here you see the design. We won it about 4 months ago, and we are now in the elaboration phase. It's in the city center of Seoul. Here you see the famous river that used to be a motorway viaduct that turned into a river, and here you see the famous industrial block that's a building from the 60s, which is 1 kilometer long, which is now turned into creative industry buildings. And here is the Temple of the Tombs of the Kings. And this building is a reflection of the plot structure and the system of little streets and alleys that were there before. So here you see the old fabric of that area. You see here these footpaths and alleys in between a kind of patio hutong typology that was only one story high in the old Seoul, much more beautiful than Seoul is now. And currently you see still these paths, you see still this fine plot division. But all the buildings have been taken down and they are like sheds out of corrugated metal, and they house all kinds of small-scale workshops. So our proposal was to create a kind of interpretation of that pattern and turn that into different building segments for the building. What they normally do in Korea is you have this site, then you just bulldoze it so that it's completely empty. And then you create a couple of Samsung glass skyscrapers that form a kind of ensemble around the courtyard. And then there's no relationship with the history of the city anymore. So we went in the other direction and we said we want to keep these alleys and we want to reflect something of this small scale activity. So we extruded the pattern of plots into roof terraces in the maximum height. So let's say, again, this subtraction ID, you create a maximum volume according to the height lines there, which is very high, and then you have to go down for the UNESCO site of the temple. And then we create a step down according to that height line in the form of roof terraces that are interrelated on that building. So this is the morphology. This is this new river where the motorway was, and we also create a kind of water management system to manage rainwater in a responsible way, which is also a problem in Korea, where everything is put into asphalt. So here you see the plan. The blocks are detached and connected by streets, both on the grade level as halfway in the air, and some parts are, for instance, hotel, others are residential, and again, others are offices. They are vertically separated, and then the ground floor and the intermediate level are collective. So you have functional spaces in between, and then you have collective spaces like the roof, the in-between, and the grade level, where there is a lot of archaeological stuff in the basement, because the city of Seoul, the old city of Seoul, was exactly in that spot. So the whole ground floor is partly open as an open-air museum with archaeological elements. So this is the image of a central square within the block. And you see here the intermediate bridge levels that go across. And you see here one of the co-working spaces. And you see here the roofscape of the area. And you see very clearly the step down of the different plots. And the interesting thing is we did it from another approach. As our professors when we were students. But if you really look at the block now, it looks a little bit like a 1970s Team 10 structuralist project, which could be from Hermann Hertzberger or Aldo van Eyck or somebody like that. And it is done intentionally because we want, you know, this is the scape of Seoul. It turns gradually and totally inert skyscrapers, which we really, it's really not a good idea to do that. And this city needs a much more human scale, and therefore we have created this proposal, which is now going to be under construction. So that's the last overview. So this is an example of subtraction, volumes taking down. And we are now, I'm now showing you what is inversion in urban design and in landscape urbanism. So this is a page out of this book, The Noise Landscape, that we just wrote, where we have 8 case studies, the most important airports in Europe, airports that are very close to city centers, which is only in Europe. And there is a synergy, like you also have here in Prague, between the airport and the city. Maybe in Prague that's still coming up, but in Amsterdam, in Zurich, in Vienna, this is already for a long time going on. It turns the airport in an urban node. It creates an urbanization process specifically around the airport, and it creates a kind of coexistence between the city and the airport, contrary to what happens in China or in the United States, where airports are 50 miles out of town and they are just in the middle of nowhere, creating an enormous amount of mobility and unsustainable development. Airports near cities produce a nuisance, but at the same time they are also the most sustainable airports, which is an interesting paradox to work on. So as an example, I show you Amsterdam. This is the noise contour of Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. And you see it lies neatly between the different development areas of Amsterdam, of Haarlem, of Hoofddorp, of Aalsmeer, and of Leiden. And if you look at this picture, you see what probably would have happened here if the airport would have not been there. If the airport would have not been there, Haarlem and Amsterdam and Hoofddorp and Aalsmeer and Leiden would have become one big city. And this has not happened because of the noise contours and the emission legislation. And for instance, this runway here has been specifically projected there. It's about 10 kilometers from the terminal in order not to hinder the urban condition. And this is super interesting because you can also invert this idea and say, okay, the noise contour of the airport and the presence of the airport has a positive effect on urbanization in the sense that it kept a green heart open between the cities, and it prevents the cities to create an enormous sprawl of urbanization. So we propose to create a landscape park out of the whole noise contour area, which, if you would do that, would be about as big as the natural park that is formed by the dunes here, or the natural park that is waterland here, or three other examples there. And in fact, this is also happening. So there's, on the one hand, there's an uncontrolled urbanization moving towards and from the airport, directly around the airport. On the other hand, there's a very conscious planning going on the edge of the airport. So this is a park that is designed by H&S landscape architects, which is a deliberate attempt to create leisure and sports area directly next to the runway by making dikes that are designed in such a way that they disperse the noise. So the noise is reduced by the form of the dikes of the park, and at the same time the park has become a very popular, almost land art-like destination for people to visit. Another aspect is that we have the Amsterdam forest here with a lake, which is one of the wedges that green go into the city, and here between the airport and the forest is a new golf course. Many airports are owning golf courses and are building golf courses and keep them in their property. Why? Because they have discovered that it is not only a kind of wasteland that you fill with some sports. They have discovered that golf courses are economic engines for the airport region. So pilots, cargo, entrepreneurs, politicians, and other people that do something with aviation are playing golf there together and do business and discuss about the development of the airport and create new economic activities. It's a very interesting phenomenon. I don't like golf at all. I hate it. But let's say as an economic spatial phenomenon in relation to what I'm saying here, it's very interesting. So Incheon Airport in Korea, for instance, has two golf courses, and this golf course here is the most popular golf course in the whole country and almost in the whole of Asia. There are a lot of Grand Slam plays there, and if you ask them about the noise, most golfers said, we like airplanes and we like the noise. Now this is only a joke. As I said, I don't like particularly golf. But it is a sign that negative parameter or the negative constraint of, for instance, a noise production source can also be a motorway, should not always be considered totally negative and then lead to a kind of cynical design with noise walls, etc., but can also be turned into a positive point of departure to think in a new way about urban design or landscape architecture. So in that sense, we have been working on the city of Montpellier in France. Here you see the city of Montpellier, and here you see the airport, and here you see the Mediterranean Sea. Now what happened in Montpellier is quite shocking. Namely, they planned a new TGV high-speed railway line from Nîmes to Barcelona. And this is a typical French planning. It's centralist, doesn't take care of any barrier in the landscape or in the city. And, you know, you don't understand why, but they just miss the city. You know, they just go past the city. This is a disease in France, because in France the railway company is autonomous, and their task is to create a high-speed railway network which is as fast as possible and has as few stops as possible. And the result is that they sometimes put the railway stations in between cities, and you have to drive there to get your plane, your train, which causes a lot of mobility, and it causes a lot of shitty urban development and sprawl. So also here they plan the railway station there, whereas now the TGV is going through the heart of the station. Here you see the existing motorway. They also want to have a new motorway, and this will turn into a ring road. So this is a typical project where you think of an urban designer, what the hell are they doing there? But this is also the contradictory challenge part of my inversion approach, namely, you can say, oh, this is not good, I don't want to have anything to do with it. But if you say that, then you know that there will be people producing shitty urban designs. So we say, okay, let's take the assignment and let's try to make the best out of it by preventing large-scale urbanization. So this is a line through the landscape that I have been designing. And it consists of the motorway and the new high-speed railway line put together. In the plans of the railway and motorway company, they were 200 meters apart, completely cutting up the landscape. Took us 7 months to get them together. And we were at the end at the table of the Minister of Traffic in Paris, and the minister forced the motorway and railway company to put it together. Later on, the working drawings of the two were putting transformator houses in the middle of the motorway and vice versa, but that was being solved quite soon. So here you see our proposition. The proposition takes care of the contours of the noise that go across here and use it not to do something boring or to kind of be cynical or resigned. No, we create here a beautiful park landscape where existing agriculture, vineyards, and also old estates and farms can stay. We also make use of the floodscapes of the streams that are there and turn them into parks for the future area, not going to be built there. And then here you see the bundle of the railway and the motorway. We create a part of an underground part here, and we create a bridge here, and we create a noise reducing urban typology in between in order to create as less nuisance as possible. By putting these together, you can also cross them in one go by a platform, and you can lay a tramway that goes from the city center to the airport. And then you have a new urban node crossing between motorway, railway, and tramway. So you can organize park and ride here. You can have a little concentration here, and the rest can be a kind of quiet park landscape. You see it from another side, and you see quite clearly here the blocks that protect the motorway or that protect the neighborhoods from the motorway and the TGV that's running here. And the railway station will be a kind of mixture between an urban square and a park where the trains are, let's say, also stopping in the green. It's very important to have such strong frameworks. And then you can say, I first fix the qualities of the landscape. Then I fix the necessary infrastructure. Consequently, I create a green framework of public spaces and the main access roads, and those are fixed. And whether this is going to be filled with a lot of urbanization or not is not important, but we constrain a maximum of urbanization, and the urbanization is only in parts, in phases being accomplished. So for instance, this is one quarter, this is one quarter, this is one quarter, this is one quarter. This quarter does not need to be built. So we also created a framework in which you say, okay, it's not necessary to build, but if you want to build, you can make a kind of balance between built and unbuilt, between nature and construction. And this is the way that we work from the perspective of this inverted idea of working with nuisance, with negative constraints in a positive way. So here you see also how the neighborhoods are clearly embedded within the green framework of that master plan of urban design. So you could say that these constraints are breaking factors. They hinder urbanization, and you use them to canalize urbanization. So in my terminology, urban design is like skiing. It's the art of breaking elegantly. So that's an inverse approach against somebody who says urban design is the art of motor racing. I go as fast as I can, you know? So what are those factors? For instance, in Switzerland, we have at least 10 factors. One is the forest law. You're not allowed to cut trees. The second one is the landscape legislation, which protects landscape views in the country. The third one is a very interesting one. In Switzerland, you have to have a minimum surface of agricultural land per resident in order to feed the population independently in times of catastrophes or war. Then you have the regional zoning plan. In Switzerland, contrary to the Netherlands and to Germany, there's a regional zoning plan which determines where you are allowed to build and where you are not allowed to build. That is not the authority of the municipality. It's the authority of the province, of the canton, which means that you cannot get urbanization competition between different villages and towns, which leads a lot of times to sprawl. Then we have the noise contours, then we have water management, we have the topography. In Switzerland, over 800 meters, nobody wants to live because it's too far up. We have very big fragmented property. This is also a very good case of breaking elegantly. If your property is fragmented and your country is a liberal social democracy, and repossession of land by authorities is only allowed in specific cases, then you are retarding, you are delaying fast development. Then we have stakeholders, direct democracy, which have a lot of influence and emissions. So if you add it all up, it's very difficult to create large-scale urban development, and this is good. So that's why I say our approach to urban design is inverse. We try to prevent over-urbanization instead of that we want to construct as much urbanization as possible. So it's like an architect who says, I'm an architect who doesn't want to build necessarily. He only wants to build unless there is a strong reason to construct. So this is the first part of my lecture. The second part of my lecture is the so-called grand projet. I'm working a lot on complex, large-scale urban design projects, like, for instance, the master plan of Hafen City in Hamburg. These projects are a phenomenon. They are happening all over the world. And it's an urban typology that in the meantime is embedded in history of urban design that you cannot ignore it and you have to deal with it. There's a lot of talk today by politicians, by urbanists, by architects, we should go small scale, we should go decentralized and democratic. But this is not happening on the scale of large cities and buildings. Large cities of buildings build big projects, have always been big projects. The Colosseum is an example, or the plan of Sixtus from the 15th century in Rome is an example. The Haussmann plans in Paris are examples, the Louvre. It has been happening throughout history and it will not stop. So how do we deal with these projects? One of them is Hafen City. And you see that Hafen City is a big project on the one hand, but on the other hand, you see there's an enormous diversity of different architectures, of smaller plots of mixed use and of kind of multi-directional street pattern where everything is more or less walkable. So this is the way to tackle a large project, to create the development principle that allows for maximization of the development of such a project, mostly around a railway station or something like that, but at the same time creates adaptability, creates inclusiveness, and creates the physical matrix on the basis of which you can create diversity, social diversity, functional diversity, that of course is reciprocal to each other. And of course, such projects in cities that have a lot of industrial sites never stops. So for instance, this is the Hafen City in Hamburg, which on the moment is completed until here. So it's about 70% completed. They are already working on this, and consequently one makes a jump across the river here, which was politically endorsed by creating here the proposal for the Olympic Games in Hamburg for 2024, which was cancelled by a referendum. So we made the urban design for this Olympic Games that was not designed as Olympic Games, but was designed as an urban neighborhood of the future, a mixed-use, diverse urban neighborhood of the future, and then temporarily allocated to the Olympic Games. This was also not new. We did this already in London together with Arup and Elias Morrison for the Olympic Legacy in London. And it was years before always also already been done by the authorities in Barcelona when Barcelona hosted the Games. It's a kind of tool to trigger development with another goal, but use this momentum and the financial effort that is being produced to realize a goal which is much more sustainable and lays much further in the future. So this site is part of the idea of connecting Hamburg with Harburg. This is not a mistake in spelling. Harburg is really existing. It's the town on the other side of the Elbe. It's a smaller town, and they are kind of twins, Hamburg and Harburg, and the Hafen City is here. Then there's a big island called Wilhelmsburg, where the IBA has been built. Maybe you know about it. And this site where the Olympia was proposed is in between. So here you see the sequence of the city center, then the Hafen City, then this development, and then going down to Wilhelmsburg to Harburg. And this will then be more or less the image that in the future will be there. This stadium will be scaled down from 40,000 to 20,000 or 15,000 people. This will be a permanent swimming pool. The Olympic Hall will be turned into cruise terminal, additional cruise terminal. And these blocks, they are built as normal dwellings and temporarily reconfigured into Olympic Games projects. So this was being wiped out by a referendum last year, but the design is still actual. So the Olympic Games are not going to be taken ahead, but the project is going forward. So this is the maybe an example of how you do this approach with these big projects in an inner city. This is a kind of graph that shows the increase of large-scale projects in cities all over the world. Both the size and the amount of cities is growing all the time, and therefore also the amount and the size of these big projects. We selected 26 big projects in 15 countries to look at in a kind of research project that we do in our Future Cities Laboratory in Singapore. This is a lab which is owned by our school, ETH, which consists only of PhD students who are doing research on different types of architecture and urbanism, and I'm doing a research on these big projects. And research is what kind of projects are they, why are they emerging, how are they being done, and where are they. So we selected 8 projects: the Pudong Island, Liuyatui in Shanghai, Tokyo Station, Marinouchi, West Kowloon, which is the new high-speed railway terminal from China, Marina Bay in Singapore in Asia. And then we had La Défense in Paris, King's Cross in London, Hafen City in Hamburg, and Barcelona 22 EPT. We researched them on conception, how are they being conceived, a design, implementation, how are they built, and what is their implication, how are they working in their surroundings, connected to adaptability and inclusiveness. So we depict them in the same way. You see, for instance, Hafen City, there you see Liuyatui, Shanghai, you see King's Cross, there you see La Défense, etc. We look at them within the context of their own city. So they are, King's Cross is not the only large project in London, of course. There are many more. One of them is, for instance, Canary Wharf, that is now being extended. And Canary Wharf is a kind of bad project from the past, like La Défense in Paris. It's a monofunctional big banking office compound that has been landing like an aircraft carrier in the harbor. And then it was also gated because the developers, they created a condition in which you only can enter it by a guard. So we call these projects wolves, whereas we call projects like Hafen City sheep, because they are open, they're diverse, small scale, and you see a gradual evolution of these projects from the 1960s and 70s, monofunctional, large-scale, top-down, to more diverse, democratically supported projects nowadays in specifically West European cities. Whereas in Asia, they still construct these projects on the old top-down way. But sometimes these wolves also turn into sheep, because if they exist long enough, like Canary Wharf, they attract housing, they attract subway stations, they attract amenities, so they attract a certain urban complexity around them. It's the same as has been happening to La Défense. So gradually they turn inside out, so from a kind of bad guy, they turn into an urban centrality, into a real ground project that becomes important both for the social and economic and transport facilities for the whole city. So these are aspects that we research. You see clearly that La Défense was only a little core in the beginning and now is kind of swarming out and doesn't consist anymore out of only offices, but has a very diverse development and creates a whole kind of city center within the city, a city within the city, if you like. This is Liuyatui in Shanghai, and you see here, this is exactly what, of course, we do not want to do in Europe on the moment anymore, where you create giant skyscrapers that just stand in the asphalt in the middle of nowhere without any quality public space. You can very well see it when you look here. This is Liuyatui, and this is Wall Street on the tip of Manhattan. You see that Wall Street is looking a little bit diverse, almost in a kind of street pattern way, like Hafen City, but also has skyscrapers. It's very high, but this height doesn't affect the relationship and the townscape of it. Whereas here you see the same density. All these towers are just standing in the middle of nowhere and telling the other, I am more high or I am more beautiful than you. And it is just—it's also a development, a real estate disaster. The good news is that it's such a real estate disaster that it's—that they're completely changing the townscape and the ground floor level of that area more towards this direction. An interesting aspect is, in that sense, is Singapore, where we have this Future City Lab, which has a kind of history of projects that change over time into more sustainable projects. So the beginning was skyscrapers in the middle of nowhere. Then they started to do inclusive projects with shopping malls and hotels and office towers and residential together in a kind of garden with big interconnected inside pedestrian movement. This looks almost like a Piranesi map, as you see. This is a connectivity system between different indoor areas. Singaporeans don't like to be outside because it's so hot and humid, which we now try to teach them not to do, to go outside. And this is a comprehensively designed project, also in one go by American architects. And you can see the contrast with the old urban tissue and street pattern and diverse block and plot structure that we have next to it. So this is an interesting model to look at it. Here you see the old city center diversity. Here you see this 1960s-70s skyscraper development. Then you see this kind of all-encompassing mono project. Then you go to Marina Bay, where there is they start to work with public space, they start to work with streetscapes, they start to work with grade level activity in the blocks, and finally they start in this section here with a real European townscape. So here you see this second CBD area, where they start to experiment with real streets and with real street patterns, etc. But still, they are buildings that are too big in floor plate, like Canary Wharf. And here you see the last project, which is extremely intricate and is consisting of half open courtyards that are communicating with the street, there's street life, there are schools in between, towers are modest, they are a little bit circumferential, and they have their own story about developing building blocks. So it's not for nothing that the renderings that are emerging there, this is a rendering of that last project in Singapore, it's very much looking like, for instance, this picture of Hafen City. They are really looking like the European urban condition in order to recreate that in a kind of natural, ventilated way in the tropical climate in Singapore. And the next project will be this one here in a container terminal, which is also a project where we are research doing work, design work on from ETH as a kind of service to the National Planning Authority over there. So now I would like to show you a little film of a project that we are working on now. Okay. I will say nothing for the next 4.5 minutes, and then after that you can I can explain something, or you start screaming at me. This is the biggest urban design that we ever did. It is 4 million square meters of development around the new high-speed railway station from Singapore to Kuala Lumpur. After this film, I will try to convince you that we turned a bad idea into a quite sustainable solution. I would have chosen other music. Maybe Bach. Don't you think that the building mass is a little bit like a fugue of Bach? We do these renderings in our office. The buildings, for instance, we have an algorithm that can create different depth facades so that you do not draw these buildings. You just push a button and they go. Okay, what's so special about this? We were working on this research on these big projects, looking at the pros and cons and how they emerge, but also always from the consciousness of they happen due to economic, political reasons, and they will always happen. So what are the drivers of these projects and how could you influence them? Then there came a competition for the Jurong Lake District and we decided to apply for the tender. There were nine officers were selected. One of them was Graham Morrison from Alison Morrison, who was also here for a lecture, and also us. And we won this competition. This was interesting for us because we could combine the research that we did together with our urban design experience of inversion and subtraction together with the brief of such a project. So this is the city of Singapore. It's a city and an island at the same time, and it consists of the center, and then there are the ideas to create three additional centers. One is the gateway at the airport, one is the gateway to Malaysia, and one is the high-speed railway terminus to Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, which is connecting later to Bangkok and to China. And at the same time, this part is also part of the port area. So here you see that we propose here to not only create these centers, but also create a kind of development corridors where you create functional divisions and create here, because there are a lot of universities and research labs here, a kind of knowledge corridor. And here you see there's a lake there and there's a river creek going down to the sea. One of the proposals that we won because of is that we did not build on the park and the lake, which the brief was asking for, But we kept the whole area green and concentrated the whole development on a smaller area than originally was given. So if you look at the overview here, this whole area was also subject to construction in the brief. And we, this is a peninsula on the moment, and we created this canal, enlarging the lake and the river, creating another island that is not constructed on, or at least not above ground, and then concentrated the construction of the neighborhood on a smaller area. Then we had the underground high-speed railway line that comes in here and ends here with the railway station, with two metro stations on either side, a bus station here, another metro station here, which is already existing, with another bus station. Created a connector from which you can serve all these stations, but left the whole high-speed railway zone green into a park, so we do not construct on it. The advantage is that it is an enormous saving of construction costs. At the same time, you create an enormous amount of green surface in addition. And last but not least, you can build very near to this, let's say, this concrete tunnel where the railway station is in. And this real estate creates an enormous quality. The same we did with the motorway. There's a motorway running here, a six-lane motorway in the direction of Kuala Lumpur also. So we completely put it underground and turned it into a park. So the whole system of green spaces become park connectors and also ecological zones between different parts of the island. Therefore, we had to really concentrate and densify the construction area. And we did that by making obligatory, again in this idea of subtraction, fill up completely the volume of the built possibilities. So the maximum height was 140 meters there because there are a military airport in the neighborhood. So we made it obligatory to make all buildings the same height, to give them as much roof surface as possible, and to make it obligatory to create a roof garden on top of every tower. Then we created slenderness rules, referring to the first project I show you in the beginning of the lecture in Rotterdam, that these towers are slender, but that they have a certain freedom of where they can stand. And then they land on podia. As you saw in all these projects I showed you, we never put towers that are standing on the ground, but we always create these kind of podia socles that here are also creating narrow streets that have shade and that are directed into the direction of the wind in order to produce a maximum of natural ventilation. The podia of these building blocks are also obligatory green parks, so that the so-called 100% replacement rule, which is a new rule in Singapore, which says every building that you make has to be creating roof gardens of the same size of its footprint. So it's that's why it's called 100% replacement rule. And you see all the infrastructures underground, which costs a lot of money, because of the density, you earn it back and you can pay for it. So here you see the plan. Here you see this park connector, this between the different transit hubs. And we also created a transitional concept for the mobility. In the end, it will be a car-free area. And the car-free area will have street profiles that can adapt over time to new conditions. So this is the condition from the start, when there is still not enough public transport to reduce car traffic in the neighborhood. But later on, when the public transport is really realized, then you can reduce streets, not allow private cars anymore, create only bus lanes, bicycle roads, etc. So this is the night view of such a street. where there will also be a lot of new mobility devices running around. And here you see the public space on top of the motorway. Here you see the railway station underground. And here you see this connector that connects the different other principal transport nodes. You see very clearly here this, you create a kind of carpet of green in the air by this obligation to make these roof gardens, and you also create a very clear green area here. This is not just green that looks nice, but in the tropics it's possible to create roof grounds that are about, have a coverage of land, of soil of about 1 meter, and then planting. And this planting and the coverage of soil contributes to the cooling of the buildings. Buildings have to be constantly cooled. 50% of the energy consumption of tropical cities is air conditioning. And the rain that falls on the roof feeds the plants, first of all, is being kept by the soil, is partly evaporating, and by evaporating, it contributes to the cooling of the roof surface, which is one of the most important surfaces to be cooled. So here you see this interconnector between the different stations. It has a people mover on the first level, and it has a free lane for electric mobility on grade level. And it is not air conditioned because there's a special roof construction out of louvers. And there is we make use of the facades that are not double glazed, and therefore the cooling of the facades make this space a little bit cool. And then there's water and water pipes in the pavement that that are fed with cold water in order to create this into an agreeable space. So it's one of the first spaces that is not air conditioned in that area. Here you see the high-speed railway station. Here you see one of the connectors to the metro station. And here you see the reference to existing diverse street patterns that we have been working on. The street pattern is in the direction of the wind, so that you have a maximum cooling effect. We have different quarters, and we anticipate on typologies that are emerging in the tropics, like you see here, where this 100% green replacement rule already leads to buildings that have very lush and quality roof gardens. These are examples that are really built. They are not illusionary. This is the tower where our Urban Future Cities Lab is housed. So I'm here every 2 months for a couple of days. We are also creating this typology of co-working and ecosystems of related economic activity that I talked to you about what we do in Zurich with Google also. That means that the plinth of buildings does not look closed in, but looks more like this. They are spaces that are adaptable and can house different types of dedicated spaces of encounter that are also cross-ventilated. They can accommodate lobbies of buildings. They can accommodate connections between building blocks. And they can be extended across streets or confined to different buildings. So this is an image what this project looks like. These are not buildings that we design. These are built. These are just renderings that are the result of the rules that we apply to this specific urban design. You see these podia, you see perforations and patios in the podia, you see ground level activity with porosity, you see setbacks for towers, you see that towers are slender, you see that there are different momentum areas, datum areas, that are reserved for these green levels. And this has to steer the development of the project. So a building block is not a closed building anymore, but it is a reworked open structure of patios and atria around which the spaces are grouped, spaces that look like this inside and that look like this outside. This is the area now. So you see here this peninsula. This is the idea that the city had to completely construct this whole area. And this is what we do. We kind of reframe here. We create these enormous green spaces and we concentrate building typologies on very limited plot size and create a maximum verticality in the third dimension. This is a cultural difference between Europe. We don't like to live somewhere here. But in Asia, this is not a problem, and it's also a physical necessity because the cities are so dense and they are so so large that compactness in a vertical way really contributes to a more sustainable condition in terms of energy balance and in terms of balance in general. And it is part of the culture there that does not have a problem with living in the air. So here you see the roofscape and here you see the lake that is going to be preserved by concentrating these buildings. You see another picture of that green network as well as the blue network as well as the walkable network, which is much more fine than has been realized so far. You see here peripheral parking spaces so that cars do not penetrate into the area. And this is an illustration of that green, 100% green replacement, which is also connected to different plant species. Some of them work and some of them don't work, and some of them work on roofs and some of them work along facades. If you look at this beautiful building by Woha Architects, the Oasis Hotel, it has a kind of mesh outside, which is completely turning into green ivy on the moment, which produces sunshade, is being moistured by water, and therefore also contributes to the cooling of the area. So I think I gave you an overview of, first of all, what we mean by our approach of subtraction and inversion, and secondly, how we deal with projects that may seem in the beginning unsympathetic, but then can be turned in very exciting and maybe also a little bit cutting edge solutions for future development. Thank you very much.